In this video, formation of lymph will be discussed. In the last video, we discussed on lymphatic vessels. Hope you guys watched it. If not, please do watch the video for better understanding, before proceeding to this video. The link of the video is given in the description. So, let's start with the microcirculation and capillary system. Microcirculation is the most important part of the circulatory system, as transport of nutrients to the tissue and removal of cell waste occurs. Each nutrient artery that enters the organ branches 6 to 8 times to form the arterioles, then each arteriole branches 2 to 5 times to form the capillaries. The branch of the arteriole which connects directly with capillary is called a meta-arteriole. Meta-arterioles are different from the arterioles. In meta-arterioles, the smooth muscle coat is not continuous, as in arterioles. It circles the meta-arterioles at intermittent points. At the point where capillaries arise from the meta-arteriole, there is smooth muscle fiber encircling it to form pre-capillary sphincter. This pre-capillary sphincter opens and closes to regulate the blood flow into the capillaries, according to the local condition of the tissue. The most important factor is oxygen concentration in the tissue. When there's less oxygen concentration in the tissues, these sphincters open and allows more blood into the capillaries, so that more oxygen can be delivered to the tissues. From the capillaries, venules arise and then drains into larger veins. Capillaries is made of a single layer of endothelial cells, and it is surrounded by a thin basement membrane. There are two very small pathways in the endothelium for transport of nutrients to the interstitial spaces. One of the pathway is the intercellular cleft. This cleft allows fluid, small solutes, and water-soluble ions to freely pass from the capillaries into the interstitial spaces. But albumin molecules cannot freely pass, as the cleft space is slightly narrow for the protein molecules to escape. Second pathway is the plasmolemmal vesicles. It can imbibe small amount of plasma or extracellular fluid and transport across the endothelium, as shown. These vesicles can sometime combine to form vesicular channel for the transport of nutrients from plasma to tissues or waste products from tissues into the plasma. Interstitium is made of solid and fluid parts. The solid part is formed by the collagen fiber bundles and proteoglycan filaments. Collagen bundles gives the interstitium tensional strength. The fluid in these solid spaces is called interstitial fluid. The interstitial fluid is derived from the blood capillaries by diffusion and filtration. So, the interstitial fluid is similar to plasma, but contains less of proteins. As capillaries, doesn't allow proteins to escape easily from the circulation. There are four pressures that regulate the fluid movement through the capillary membrane. First pressure is capillary pressure. The capillary pressure pushes the fluid outwards through the capillary membrane. The second pressure is interstitial fluid pressure. It tends to push the fluid into the capillaries. The third pressure is capillary plasma colloid osmotic pressure, which tends to cause osmosis of fluid into the capillaries from the interstitial spaces. The fourth pressure is interstitial fluid colloid osmotic pressure, which tends to cause osmosis of fluid into the interstitium from the capillaries. So, when all these forces are summed up, it is called the net filtration pressure. If the net filtration pressure is positive, then fluid flows across the capillaries into the interstitium. If the net filtration pressure is negative, the interstitial fluid is absorbed into the capillaries. In normal condition, the net filtration pressure is slightly positive, so that fluid flows across the capillaries into the interstitium. Now, we will discuss how the lymph is formed. The fluid that is filtered by the arterial end of the capillaries supplies the nutrients to tissues and collects the metabolic waste from the tissues. Most of the fluid is reabsorbed back into the venous end of the blood capillaries. This excess fluid that is left behind when enters the lymphatic capillaries is called the lymph. On an average per day, about 20 liters of fluid is filtered at the arterial end of the blood capillaries, and about 18 liters of this fluid is reabsorbed back at the venous end of the blood capillaries. So, if this excess 2 liters of interstitial fluid are left behind, it causes tissue edema. This is where the lymphatic system comes into role. It absorbs the excess 2 liters of the fluid and drains back into the circulatory system as lymph. So, lymphatic system forms an accessory pathway to the circulatory system, and aiding in drainage of the tissue fluid back into circulation. What regulates this lymph flow? This can easily be summarized into 2 factors. Namely, interstitial fluid pressure and activity of the lymphatic pump. When more fluid accumulates in the interstitial spaces, the interstitial pressure increases, it causes tissue to swell, the anchoring filaments, attached to the endothelial cells of the lymphatic capillaries, move apart, and allowing the excess fluid to enter the lymphatic capillaries. Once entered, the fluid cannot re-enter the interstitium due to overlapping arrangement of the lymphatic capillary endothelium, as it acts as a flap valve. Once the excess fluid is inside the lymphatic system, the flow now depends on the lymphatic pump. Lymphatic pump can be divided into intrinsic and extrinsic. Intrinsic pump is due to contraction of the lymphatic vessels by its smooth muscle fibers, which help in aiding the forward flow of the lymph. It should be noted that the backflow of the lymph in lymphatic vessels is prevented by the presence of many valves. The external pump is due to the following factors. Contraction of the surrounding skeletal muscle. Movements of the parts of the body. Pulsation of the adjacent arteries. And compression of the tissues by external objects. The pathway of the lymphatic vessels was already discussed in the previous video. We request you to watch the video for better understanding. The link of the video is given in the description. We conclude the video here. Hope it was useful. In the next video, we will discuss on the lymphoid organs. See you soon in the next video.